have access to all types of fruits and vegetables and all sorts of food products any time of the year, every day, any day. And that's completely unrealistic compared to where we were 15, 20, 30, 40 years ago.
Globalization to me means just connecting the world, like, through technology. It used to be third world countries, like, you didn't know what was going on, you didn't know about them, but now, like, through the click of the internet, you can see, or, like, they're getting technology and advancing themselves and modernizing, and the world is becoming more connected than it ever has been.
Globalization is the unification of multiple countries around the world to become unified, and to me, it seems positive.
To me, globalization means groups of people around the world being able to communicate with each other very easily, mainly through means of our new technologies created, cell phones, email, Blackberries, whatever.
I remember traveling in England, and I had a colleague in England, and he was looking at the grocery, we were looking at grocery stores, and he said, you know, when he's 20 years older than I, and he said, you know, 20 years ago, and that was 10 years ago, so 30 years ago when he was living in England, the only fruits and vegetables you could find were sort of cabbage and, you know, some apples that were local to that particular region, and so you weren't seeing avocados. You were not seeing, you know, pineapples in the grocery store fresh. You maybe have seen it canned, but it was even difficult then. So globalization has really brought us this bounty of food from all over the world in ways that we've never seen before.
The emergence of this global food system requires that negotiations address both the traditional constraints on trade, import barriers, export aids, and domestic supports, and new issues like regulation of biotechnology, curbing monopolies, ensuring non-discriminatory access to supplies, and serving the real needs of rural development. This coincides with the ideas presented in Thomas Friedman's The Lexus and the Olive Tree.
I think it depends on what kind of food items you're talking about. I mean, I know that in America, they have a lot of different dairy farms and wheat and things like that. Whereas with like the fish, for instance, you know, we don't do a lot of that here. So I think it's going to be higher for items like that and lower for items like beef and red meat and, I don't know, certain fruits and things like that.
I would say probably right around half. We're not always producing at maximum capacity. So I think that with the explosion of the U.S. population, that importation of food has probably become a pretty huge staple in our economy.
Different countries have different priorities when it comes to food safety. It's not to say that different countries are not concerned about food safety. They are. But their ability, the resources, the institutional structures, the regulatory policies are different in different places. So we can't expect the same level of food safety from abroad as we do here. There have been some important cases before the World Trade Organization dealing with food safety issues and food quality issues. Let's go back and look at a little bit of history. Back in 1994, the World Trade Organization and all of its member countries signed an agreement called the Application for the Agreement of Sanitary Phytosanitary Measures. And what this agreement did was it established guidelines for countries to establish food safety regulations when it relates to food trade. Not so much what they do in their own country in the sense of what, you know, what policies they can impose within their country, but rather on the expectations they can have for food coming into their country. And over the years, there have been just a number of disputes about this agreement. It's a fairly thin document if you ever look it up, and it doesn't tell you a whole lot. But one of the things that's important is that if a country decides to impose regulations related to food trade or the trade of other products that may affect a plant or animal health or the environment in some respects, you've got to provide a risk assessment. And there have been some questions about what exactly is an appropriate risk assessment. So there are these rules when it comes to international trade and thus the globalization of food that provide us some guidelines, but everyone doesn't agree.
Globalization to globalization has created opportunities for food producers and consumers to interact on a more widespread and personal level than ever before. And cooperation and coordination will dictate the possibilities that will be available to future generations.